All right, welcome back. I'm working on a different microphone setup. It still comes in very loud on my sound recorder. I don't know if it's going to be too high or not. Hopefully it's good enough, but I certainly don't have to speak loudly. So today we're going to conclude. Today is Wednesday, November 20. Whoa, look at that. It's November 25, almost Thanksgiving. But here in Taiwan, it's just another morning. And concluding the reading on ox herding pictures and commentaries in relation to the meek that shall inherit the earth, or the harvestable, being from the Greek original praus, as a well-tamed warhorse, as strong as can be and powerful, but also tamed in the way of gentle and cooperative. And that is in many ways the ox taming, akin to the taming of the ox, or herding of the ox or the bull, in the classic Chinese Chan pictures. I want to make a couple of initial points. It should be remembered, or as we see on the Wikipedia page, that the calf, the bull, or ox, one of the earliest similes for meditation practice, and we see it Majjhima Nikaya, Diga Nikaya, and there's actually a write-up from somebody named Pia Tan, I believe is a Singaporean or Malaysian Chinese Buddhist, integrating Mahayana and Theravada, and he spoke about this earliest Pali canon usage of the bull or the ox as a metaphor, simile for meditation. Then, as we know, it became very popular in China from the 10th or 11th, from the 11th century on, and then particularly popular in Japan. And the initial there were multiple versions, even up to the 12th century. There were already multiple versions in the 1200s. And that the earliest may have been from somebody named Qingchu, but the one that's most common is from a Chan practitioner, Guoan Shiyuan. And then it was expanded from 4 or 5 pictures to 10. And it was, I believe that the 10 that we're using, it's interesting. I mean, some people would say that the 4 or 5 was expanded to 10, and that gave rise to the two different versions, where it either ends with all forgotten, and the image of a big sun or a big unified circle, and the boy or man, ox herd, and the bull are both vanished, called both vanished. And that's the series that comes from the community of Shuyun, or that's the version that they're presenting. And I will trust that, because he was, again, considered perhaps the last of the classic Chinese Buddhist, Chan Buddhist masters of the, you know, before the 20th century, or up to the, up into the 20th century, Shuyun. And that last picture, 10, is called Both Vanished. And other versions later have a return to the marketplace, as we know. Now, I first want to read from a couple of people's other commentaries, and you can just see some of the fine points of how it's been understood, and I think somewhat misunderstood. And so while I agree the 10 ox herding pictures obviously are representations of phases of spiritual practice or transformation, from an initial wild bull to a fully tamed bull or praus bull, to both forgotten and then either complete and perfect enlightenment, becoming one, or with all into the void, or sunyata, or returning to the marketplace, either version. there is some confusion. There is a value to nitpicking here, and I want to do a little of that high octane speculation, as someone would say. Looking into how people, particularly Mahayana influenced Westerners, get a little what I would say make some certain minor misinterpretations along the way. So the first is going to be a link from a website called jessicadavidson.co.uk, a lady, 2015, writing, Jessica Davidson, about, it's a good version, I mean, it's a good page, it brings two versions together, but there are a few different, there are three paragraphs I want to read just for this fine detail analysis. Down the page a bit, after the second presentation of the ten, she says, or wrote, "There are many different versions and translations, but they all point to the same truth." I'd agree. And here she says, "The ox is the ultimate reality, Buddha nature, the ground of existence," and that's where I don't agree. "The ox herd is the self," she continues, "the ox herd is a self, the small self, the ego," I wouldn't agree, "who starts out separate from the ox, but then slowly learns to see that self and the true self are one." Yes, that's very Advaita Vedanta influenced, of course, right? We know Ramana Maharshi and Nityananda talking about Satchitananda, when Sat and Chit are unified, there is Ananda, and that is Paramatman, which is Supreme Self. That's exactly what Paramatman is perhaps best, one way of translating Paramatman. Parma, like gate gate, paragate, parasamgate, gara, para, as beyond or supreme or ultimate, Atman meaning true self or self. So ultimate true self could be called Paramatman, beyond Atman. But that's not original Buddhist, please. So that's how Chan Buddhism in China, mixed in with Chinese Taoism, mixed in with some Hindu, you know, Advaita Vedanta teachings, because we're talking about a thousand years plus after Gautama's parinibbana, or his departure. So Gautama leaving 2,500 years ago, 1,000 years ago, 1,500 years or so after his parinibbana, we get these ox-herding pictures. And even at that time, Chinese Chan was integrating elements of Taoism and what ultimately came as Advaita Vedanta. And there is a study of Adi Shankara, one of the original founders, with Ramanujana, I think, Ramanuja, somebody, in the 10th century, or something like that, in India, integrating elements of Buddhism. So Advaita Vedanta integrated elements of Mahayana Buddhism in India, and then Chan Buddhism in China integrated elements of Taoism and some Advaita Vedanta in China. So there was this syncretism going on about 1,000 years ago, 1,000 to 1,500 years ago. So she's saying the common view that the ox is Buddha nature, the ground of existence. Well, why does it have to be tamed? True nature doesn't need to be tamed. Buddha nature doesn't need to be tamed. Buddha nature is not wild and violent. So therefore, I would say, no, the bull is actually a metaphor more for the untamed mind, particularly lower triad blockages and the undisciplined personality that has wild and violent and destructive elements that need to be tamed or made praus. So then she goes on, next paragraph, "First you must find the ox and then catch and tame it." Of course, you don't need to tame ultimate reality. You don't need to tame Buddha nature. You don't need to tame the big self. So that's where they're wrong, I think. You don't tame those things, but you do tame the wild mind or the instinctual or instinctual tendencies, the animalistic carryovers. Basically, the unregulated ways of craving and clinging and grasping and aversion and ignorance and the kleshas and the asravas. Yeah, that needs to be tamed. She goes on, "Then you befriend it and learn from it, only to discover its truth was yours all along." Right. The essence of the wild mind is the essence of being. She goes on, then she says, Buddha mind, and this is where the people get really shallow, I think. Buddha mind is your ordinary mind. An ordinary life becomes extraordinary. Ultimately, there's nothing that's not Buddha nature, and this is the realization of enlightenment. Sounds kind of easy, you know? So Buddha mind is your ordinary mind. No, I don't think so. My ordinary mind is not the same as Nityananda or Gautama's ordinary mind. Their ordinary mind is a hell of a lot more expanded and free and unbound than my mind. So ordinary life becomes extraordinary. Well, that's okay. Ra talks about the consecrate nature of everyday things, the hallowed, consecrate nature of everyday things. That is associated with 6th and 7th chakra activation. That's not ordinary mind. Ordinary mind is not 6th and 7th chakra activation. Ordinary mind has all sorts of lower triad blockage and all sorts of craving and clinging and unwholesome roots and ashravas and kleshas. Yeah, that's ordinary mind. And that's why it needs to be tamed. And that's not Buddha mind. That's the disruption in the ordinary mind. So then she says, ultimately, there's nothing that's not Buddha nature, and this is the realization of enlightenment. That, to me, is a little bit of lowering the goalposts. Finally, last paragraph I'll read from, she says, enlightenment is called Satori in Japanese Zen, and is the moment of realization of true nature, your true nature. Yes, it's a moment of realization. It's actually, it's a well understood in Zen Buddhism in Japan, even, that it's not, you know, one... I don't know whether they call it Kensho. There's Kensho and Satori. You can say multiple moments of Kensho or awakening lead to the full, final awakening of Satori. She says the moment of realization of your true nature. Ultimately, it's true nature beyond a your. Satori happens in a flash of insight, but the process leading to it tends to progress through stages. Indeed. These are shown in the pictures. Right. But it's important to remember that the path isn't linear. Maybe, yes. You may cycle through the stages many times as your understanding grows and deepens. It's more of a spiral path. You come to the same lessons over and over until you attain full realization, yes, in multiple lifetimes, in multiple dimensions. They don't talk about that because they don't see it that way. They don't see that. Anyway, final line. The ox herding pictures dramatize this process and reveal that the ordinary self is the Buddha. No. That's where, again, I disagree. There's nothing ordinary about complete and perfect enlightenment. There is, to say things are not as they appear, nor are they otherwise, that's true. And so, presumably, in complete and perfect enlightenment, you know, mountains are still mountains and rivers are still rivers, like Gautama, you know, like Chinese Chan would say. Gautama still dealt with rivers and mountains. He still ate and still walked around with a human body. But his mind is not too ordinary, and I wouldn't say that my ordinary mind is enlightenment. I would say that our true nature is Paramatman. Our true nature is the one infinite creator, right? All is one. Yep, yep, yep. But I think people have... minimized and simplified the nature of the goal, as Earth humans are wont to do, because there's nothing ordinary about the awareness of a Buddha or Nityananda or Ramana Maharshi, and guys that are really finished with all reincarnation in the octave. They're not too ordinary, actually. They can live in the ordinary world or live in the world and be regular, I guess. But you know, there's a difference between Atman and a Buddha. There's a difference between Atman or a master and Paramatman. And so most, in my view, most of the so-called masters, China, Japan, that would come back or would be living the Bodhisattva life in the marketplace or as an abbot of a temple or just as an ordinary fellow or gal, living a pretty common, regular-looking life, they're not Buddhas. Actually, they're Bodhisattvas. They're at the level of Atman, not Paramatman. Paramatman is a whole other story. And interestingly, the ox herding pictures, although the notion of the bull or the ox could be traced back to Majjhima Nikaya or the Sutta Pitaka, Pali Canon, the Taoists had their own version. It really was Taoist. It actually, or in China, I believe the basis before Chan was Taoist, and that's why you have those stars, the constellations, in the Shu Yun version, the 10 pictures, where pictures 8 and 9, they respectfully included the note, note the constellation Lyra, note the constellation Aquila or Aquila. Oh, uh-huh. D.T. Suzuki dropped that, and most versions drop that. That's Taoist. That's Taoist Chinese astrology or astronomy. And that's interesting. So another link I brought in or I found in the week from more academic source, a page called Ox Herding, Stages of Zen Practice, John M. Kohler, Department of Cognitive Science at Rensselaer Polytechnic, RPI, coming out of Columbia University, columbia.edu. There's huge, great program for East Asian studies in Columbia. I had a friend who was in it, and I went to Columbia on and off for a year and a half or so, and great, they really did great initial work, at least in the 20th century, on core East Asian studies, particularly Japanese and Chinese Buddhism. And so this is related to that. Somehow he at Rensselaer had some access or some connection to Columbia EAS. And the intro for, I just want to read the three paragraph intro from John Kohler. He said, "The 10 ox herding pictures and commentaries presented here depict the stages of practice leading to enlightenment at which Chan or Zen Buddhism aims. They dramatize the fact that enlightenment reveals the true self, okay, showing it to be the ordinary self doing ordinary things in the most extraordinary way." I wouldn't call Nityananda an ordinary fellow doing ordinary things in a most extraordinary way. You can say it, but his doing extraordinary way comes out of a massively effortful self-transformation. Going on, "The story of the ox and ox herd, separate at first but united in realization of the inner unity of all existence, is an old Taoist story. Updated and modified by a 12th century Chinese Buddhist master to explain the path to enlightenment. The ox," and here he goes again, "the ox symbolizes ultimate undivided reality, Buddha nature, the ground of all existence." Sounds like she read this. "The ox herd symbolizes the self who initially identifies with the individuated ego as a third chakra blockage, is separate from the ox, but who, with progressive enlightenment, comes to realize the fundamental identity with the ultimate reality, which transcends all distinctions." My take is that the bull is not ultimate reality, because you don't tame ultimate reality. Ultimate reality has no problem. It doesn't need any working on. You don't work on ultimate reality. You don't work on Buddha nature. You don't work on undivided reality. You work on what is obstructive. You work on blockages, distortions, chakra issues, problems. You work on what Gautama directed the attention to work on. Craving, clinging, three unwholesome roots, grasping, aversion, ignorance, kleshas, ashravas. That's what's worked on. Or that, you know, in the four forms of right effort, this is really where you get to it here. Samapadana, right effort, one of the Eightfold Noble Path, Eightfold portions of the Noble Path, associated with, it's there are two people argue about everything. There are other ways of looking at right effort, but one way is that it's the same as right exertion, and there are four forms of it. And the first is to don't pick up harmful ways. The second is put down harmful ways you've already picked up. The third is to pick up helpful ways. And the fourth is to cultivate and refine and develop the helpful ways you've already picked up. Okay, so avoid evil, do good. Which really means the first two is ox herding. The first two is particularly the first two, maybe the last two as well, but The first two particularly, don't fall into a hole, and when you fall into a hole, get out. Understand, try to avoid harmful ways. Try to stay in right speech and right action, right livelihood, and avoid wrong view and wrong speech and wrong action. And then whenever you feel or recognize that you've fallen into wrong ways, harmful ways, ways that lead to greater suffering and harm of self and other, drop them as much as you can or dissolve the roots, the karmic roots. So those are the first two forms of samapadana, or right exertion, right effort. And that's very much about taming the bull, or moving towards paraus, the well-tamed horse, the war horse. That's not work on true nature. That's work on obstruction. That's work on what needs to be put down and avoided, what's not not helpful. That's not the same as complete and perfect awakening. So to say the ox symbolizes ultimate undivided reality, Buddha nature, ground of all existence, it doesn't make sense to me. You don't have to tame it. You don't tame Atman or Paramatman. You tame your own self-generated obstructions to it, to such, to tat, to sat-chit. Sat-chit is tat-chit. Sat-chit, like sat-chit ananda. Sat as ultimate truth or reality, I see as tat, which is basically, you can say, Buddha nature. Chit as chitta, like chiddakash, or the sky of heart or mind, sky of mind, is awareness or consciousness. Ultimately, it's going to be non-subjectivist, universal, unbound awareness, rather than subjectivist, so-called ego, seven chakra blockage, subjectivist, personal sense of self. So even Atman is a stumbling block in sixth density. But subjective consciousness is fallen, and we have universal awareness, chit, of reality. Universal awareness equals sat chit. Ba-boom. The universal is sat, or reality, or truth, which is Buddha-dhamma, you can say, or is Nibban, or the deathless, or the condition of release. And awareness of that is sat-chit. That doesn't need to be tamed. You don't tame that. You don't work with that. You get to it when all the obstructions along the way have been dissolved. And so that's an interesting point. Why nobody seems to say that, I don't know. But honestly, I would imagine the early Taoists understood. And even in Majjhima Nikaya, as a bull, ox, as a simile for meditation practice, not Buddha nature. They didn't talk about Buddha nature in the Pali Canon. Buddha in the palm of your hand, everybody's a Buddha, ordinary mind is the Buddha. Nobody's talked like that in the Pali Canon. And so it was seen as an obstruction. It was seen as working through obstruction in meditation. So you can see how people lower the goalposts and then presume themselves beyond where they are, and then minimize the work needed because they don't want to look at it because it's too bitter, I guess they may think, that you're going to be reincarnating for many lifetimes before you get out of the octave. They don't even know. We're talking the octave and seven dimensions. There's very little understanding of Buddhist cosmology in the Buddhist practitioner community. Ba-boom. Very little understanding of Buddhist cosmology in the Buddhist practitioner community. Ba-boom. Except for the Theravadins, who understand the four stages of enlightenment. But this time, at this state of fallen humanity, there are not that many Sotapanna, and not that many practitioners get to Sotapanna, and that's a problem. Anyway, he goes on, and without my interruption, when the ox herd symbolizes the self, it's really the conscious mind, who initially identifies with the individuated ego, as if that's a real thing, separate from the ox, but who, with progressive enlightenment, progressive, yes, comes to realize the fundamental identity with ultimate reality, which transcends all distinctions, right? Sunya and tat, or tatata, suchness, empty of all illusory, or empty of the false belief in substantiality of differentiation. When this happens, Oxford realizes the ultimacy of all existence. That's a nice phrase, ultimacy of all existence. The you know, all is complete and whole and perfect. Or the sacred or hallowed and consecrated nature of everyday things. Yes, yes, that's right, of course. But that doesn't need to be tamed. And then that there's nothing that is not Buddha nature. That is so unhelpful to me. So my cup is Buddha nature. Ooh. Well, my cup is my cup. Calling it Buddha nature is again adding a head on the head. My cup is the cup. It's Godhead. It's infinity. It's boundless. It's sunya. It's empty. It's indescribable. It's mysterium. Yeah, okay. But to call it Buddha nature, you know, to lots of people playing games these days with their words and their understanding, like Buddha in the palm of your hand. Okay, Buddha's in the palm of my hand. I'm a Buddha. Okay. And how many more lifetimes am I going to need to get to the finish, the end of the octave? Huh? So, you can say there's nothing not Buddha nature. You can say all is the one infinite creator. Okay. But they don't like deism, so they say Buddha nature. But there is source, and there is manifestation, and there's differentiation, and it's true nature. He now understands the preciousness and profundity of the most ordinary things of life. Just like Ross said about this hallowed, consecrated nature. And one can experience that. That's contact with intelligent infinity. And when that happens, there's indescribable bliss or joy. It's above joy. It's really bliss. And how precious, how beautiful, how important, how meaningful, and how profound. Yes, ordinary things are. They're not ordinary. This is God's house. Everything is shimmering Godhead. Like that. Illuminating ordinary living with his enlightenment. There's no ordinary living at that point. But to say that Nityananda's mind is ordinary is silly. And to compare my mind to his is silly. Actually. Because he died to falsehood before he became what he is. And we haven't done that yet. Finally, the 12th century monk Guoan Shiyan, the one I spoke of, revised and expanded upon the traditional Taoist story of the ox and the ox herd by creating a series of 10 images and accompanying verses to simultaneously depict and narrate this well-known tale. Guan's version subsequently became one of the most popular and enduring versions of the parable. Nevertheless, despite the dominance of Guan's paintings, other Zen Buddhists and artists have repeatedly repainted and retranslated, and each time got worse and worse, I would imagine. Guan's immortal verses through the following centuries. It's easier to redo than to comprehend. While the illustrations of the tale vary, verses tend to be either direct or indirect translations of Guan's original verses, and their message stands unchanged, unless you get hung up with the translations, which keep changing. So that's a nice page, and I think he did a good job. You know, I think it's useful to be critical and appreciative. Critical of where there's distortion and appreciative of where there's truth and realization and beauty. So, with all that said at 11:11, and hopefully my sound is not booming, but you can turn it down. Back to the page from Zbohi Zatma, the Chuyun community, perhaps in Hungary. Going briefly through them, and I just won't go beyond this hour, another half hour or so. So, the 10 phases, their titles are Undisciplined, Discipline Begun. In Harness, Faced Round, the ox faced the ox herder. Tamed, Unimpeded, Laissez-faire. All Forgotten, Solitary Moon, Both Vanished. And it's not for no good reason that the Shuyun community used this series that ends with All Vanished. That may well be the Chinese classical style, while the Japanese took it to coming back to the marketplace, which sounds nice, and it sounds very much like San Francisco Zen Center and Green Gulch and Tassajara. But actually, the Chinese basis probably ended with Both Vanished. Because that is a supreme attainment that is the basis of unending perfect service. I mean, where is perfect service other than the guardians who are free of the octave? I mean, we're learning. They're learned. They're finished. And so Buddha, Nityananda, and Weibu Sayadaw and other guys that are really finished with all 31 planes render infinite, endless, perfect service forever. No? A whole lot more than going back to the marketplace with bliss-bestowing hands and a big belly. So, okay. Now, let's jump into each of them, and I'll do my best. Undiscipline, number one. And actually, the Columbia University, or John Kohler's page, uses a different translation, obviously, because their series ends with in the world and bliss bestowing hands. That's D.T. Suzuki. You know, they're each version over the centuries of retranslation involved lots of folks who had no complete enlightenment putting in their two cents and ultimately diluting the original. And so it may not be that there was ever any phrase with bliss bestowing hands, but that came from some Japanese guy who retranslated it 300 years later or something, or somebody retranslated his translation centuries later. But from the Shuyun series, Undisciplined number one, the translation is, with his horns fiercely projected in the air, the beast snorts, madly running over mountain paths, farther and farther goes astray. Dark cloud, I'm gonna read it closer to the Chinese original, as I can tell you. The Chinese original is tight, tight, tight. Tight, tight, tight. Who said that? Remember? That's a little Austin Powers reference. Tight. Okay. Undisciplined. I'm undisciplined. With horns fiercely projected in air, beast snorts, madly running over mountain paths, farther and farther goes astray. Dark clouds spread across valley entrance. Who knows how much fine, fresh herb trampled under wild hoof. Chinese, very tight, very nice. The first from the, I'm not sure, again, it may be one of D.T. Suzuki's favored translations there, Search for the Bull, number one. In the pasture of the world, I endlessly push aside the tall grasses in search of the bull. Following unnamed rivers, lost upon interpenetrating... See, they didn't talk that way. Lost upon interpenetrating paths of distant mountains. My strength failing, my vitality exhausted. I cannot find the bull. I only hear locusts chirping through forest night. And I'll tighten it. In world pasture, endlessly pushing aside tall grasses, searching bull, following nameless rivers, lost, winding paths, distant mountains, strength failing, vitality exhausted, cannot find bull, hearing only locusts chirping through night forest. That's closer to how things were 1,000 years ago, if you'd like to know. Number two from Shuyun, Discipline Begun. I possess straw rope. I pass through his nose. Pass it. For once, he makes frantic attempt to run away, but severely whipped and whipped. You don't whip true nature. You don't whip Buddha nature, please. Beast resists training with all the power in wild nature ungoverned. But I, a simple ox herd, never relax, pulling tether and whip. And it's very interesting that in the DT, let's call it the DT Suzuki version from the EAS, East Asian Studies site, John Kohler, later in the verses, verses 8, 9, 10, and even starting earlier, 7, all four of them have the line, I have abandoned whip and ropes. 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 Very good. So you see, you know, there's beauty everywhere and value all sorts of places. You know, dragons and snakes commingle, said the Chinese Buddhists, meaning the highest and the lowest rub shoulders in this world. And so even in a translation that I criticize, I see something wonderful. Four times repeated, I have abandoned whip and ropes. That's very important. The end of the path, the second half of the path, right? Seven, eight, nine, ten, the last 40%. Abandoned whip and ropes. No need to self-punish. No need to self-discipline in the way of whip and rope. Whip and rope are both longitudinal or long strips of something used to hold down and beat. What do you do with a whip? You whip. What is that? What is whipping? A punishing. It's disciplining. It's harshly coercing. There's no need to harshly coerce the self in any way. There's no need to tie down free expression in any way. This is just like Confucius saying that something, you know, at 50 or 60 or 70, finally he could act freely without harming heavenly nature. Something like that. It took decades, and this is the case for everybody, please, that it takes decades or many, many lifetimes so that we can freely express ourselves without getting into trouble, without making trouble, without falling into asrava and klesha and clinging and craving and unwholesome roots, without making trouble, without karmic binding. It takes a long, long time so that there can be free expression without that. But here you're saying, you know, it's shown that the latter portions of this path, and I think that's absolutely true, involve increasing freedom and license. I'm unlicensed. I'm not licensed to do anything or regulated. I don't have a regulation. I don't have a state board certification. I act freely. But can you act freely with complete ahimsa? Only in the later stages of the path is that possible. And by calling the bull Buddha nature, this actually is people who end up extending license to themselves to harmful activity before they're ready for true, free, unlicensed expression. You have to whip and rope before you can abandon the whip and rope. And you don't apply the whip and the rope to Buddha nature. You apply it to the lower triad blockages or distortions, harmful ways, misunderstanding. You know, misunderstanding is a problem too. Wrong view. Oh, I thought you meant that. Oh, I thought that was happening. Oh, I didn't know. That's all to be applied, you know, some kind of taming needs to be applied to wrong view too. So anyway, I think it's lovely in the last four here in the DT Suzuki version, I'll call it, that again and again and again, even though they forgot the stars of the Akila and Lyra, they've added this point, I've abandoned whip and ropes. And that's very important, and one can reflect on that rightly. So, next one, I'll read it again. Discipline begun. I possess straw rope. I pass it through his nose. At once, frantic attempt running away, but severely whipped and whipped. Beast resists training with all his power of nature, of wild nature, wild ungoverned nature. but I, simple Oxford, not relaxing my pulling tether and ready whip. Number three, in harness. Gradually getting into harness, beast now content, led by nose. Crossing streams, walking along mountain paths, he follows every step I lead. I lead, holding rope tightly, my hand never letting go. All day long, alert, almost unconscious, fatigue. Meaning, this is the long portion of work where you sit and 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 you sit, and it goes from violent to boring. And like in therapy, the great work comes after crisis. The chronic, working on the chronic, follows completing the acute. When the acute is no longer a problem, it's the chronic we must address. And the chronic is wrong view, psychological issues, old wounding unhealed, old patterns that are harmful, trigger abilities, emotional trigger abilities, and their bases. So in harness, the mind that is in picture three, in harness, already lightening. The color's already going from black to white. The mind is already lighter, more conscious. The subconscious is more conscious. Self-awareness is greater. There's an easier experience of living in your own skin. But still, there's need for control. Control meaning watching the mind carefully. But there's still whipping going on, presumably, periodically. And so sometimes one has to be harsh with oneself. But there comes a time when that's completely unnecessary. But if you drop the whip and the rope too soon, then you go into the way of the Shambhala community, perhaps. So, meaning Trungpa's legacy, which was problematic. The leader holds the rope tightly. You know, they go from first person to second or third person here. So in harness, even though a relationship is building between the conscious mind as representative of Atman and the lower triad blockage bull, slowly lightening, yet still susceptible to harm, to doing harm, still volatile, and still needing some kind of heavy-handed work. You still have to be careful with your mind for a long time. and some people drop that too soon, and some people overdo it. So not too tight, not too loose, the lute string. And if you over-dominate, in this life, went the way of over harsh whipping and roping my mind for a time. Then I had a very clear dream which broke me out of that. But too harsh is a problem. You don't want to kill your bull, you know. You don't want to kill the horse. Then he'll never be trained. He'll be dead, and you'll be unhappy and make trouble. So, yet a lot. There's the long long phase of the path. That is the middle, and it's not so exciting, but it gradually leads to great transformation. And actually, what you see here in the pictures, pictures 1, 2, and 3, the Shu Yun series, initially you have a black cloud and a very jet black bull. Number 2, you have no more black cloud and a very mildly lightening bull, still wild. Number 3, you have a much more lightened bull and a little bit of the sun behind the clouds. The sun slowly emerging from the clouds, the mind in harness, the distortions instinctual distortion tendency. The line of least resistance. The bull is the line of least resistance. Gautama said the path is like swimming upstream. The bull is the line of least resistance, mind swimming, mind flowing naturally downstream. Meaning the monkey mind, the craving mind, the clinging mind, the unwholesome, harmful mind, the binding self, binding mind, the bad roots forming mind. That's the line of least resistance. That's flowing downstream naturally. That's the easy. The easy. And that has to be worked on. And swimming upstream is taming the bull. Boom. Same. And that's a piece of work. But it's in picture three, in harness, we start to see the sun. It's still small. It's not even fully in the picture. It's associated with clouds. But it appears. In number four, the bull faced around. His front half is white now. His head and front legs and half the torso is white. His tail, his back legs, his genitalia, his lower triad, his lower portion, right? His chakras 4 through 1, 1 through 4, or 5 through, maybe it looks like first four chakras are still black. But the sun is now clearly visible. The clouds are gone. And that's number four, faced round. After long days training, result appears, beast faced round. Nature, so wild, ungoverned, finally broken, become gentler. But tender, not yet given him, meaning the, but I, the Oxford, but I not yet gives, not yet in full confidence. Still holding straw rope, tying ox to tree. I like the original Chinese. That's, you know, that's just my own reconstruction. But there's a lot of junky English words that are unneeded. After a long day's training, result shows beast faced round. So wild, ungoverned nature, broken, become gentler. But I, not yet full confident, still straw rope tied to tree. But the sun has come out, and his head and front four is white. But he's tied to a tree. And so there's still, the beast is settling down, the mind is settling down, the line of least resistance is ending, and a new norm is establishing. The new norm is a virtuous mind. A peaceful mind, a clear mind, self-acceptance, self-understanding. Deeper healing is progressing. Number five, tamed. Again, the sun is visible, and we start to see rivers and mountains in the distance, which to me, you know, in pictures one, we have a foreground only. Dark cloud, black bull, some rocks and tree. Nice looking trees. Flowers. But a foreground only. Number two, we start to see a background where there's mountains in the distance. But no sun yet. And the bull is still all black. Number three, in harness, the sun comes out. There's no background either, because it's very much a foreground-based process of harnessing the bull. It's close attention to mind training. And there's a river in the front, so there's some kind of flowing along, crossing paths, covering distance, even though, because they're walking, he's in harness and walking. So action is happening, but it's still a very foreground-based picture. Number four, faced round, we start to see some bigger background. The sun is far away, but quite clear. And there's an empty background, actually. It's a background of space. And the bull is, there's a settling down. You mean, the bull is tethered now, but he's half white. And he's not so violent. So number five is tamed. Under green willow, by ancient mountain stream, ox free, pursuing his own pleasures, no tether. At eventide, God, eventide, at evening, evening gray mist descending on pasture, I go homeward with bull following quietly. Under green willow tree, by ancient mountain stream, bull free, following his own pleasure. At evening, gray mist on pasture, I go home with bull quietly following. And there we see some very interesting, very Chinese background. Looks like some kind of big mountain or big rock face. The sun is visible again. There's still some clouds, but the bull is 75% white and no tether. He's tamed. That's pros. 6-5 is number is pros. Or 5 and 6, we see pros has begun. Pros begins with 5, tamed. And that's basically 75% white. Not yet finished. And the lower, right, the genitalia and the tail, back legs are still blackish or black and white. So, but that's tamed. 75% is enough, I guess. 6, unimpeded. And again, we see some mountains and clouds. The sun is not there. On and the translation, on green field, bull contented, lying, idling his time away. I mean, I'm sure that was not the original, but on the verdant field, beast contentedly lies, idling time away, no whip needed, nor any restraint, meaning no rope, no whip, no rope needed. I, too, sit leisurely under pine tree, playing peaceful, overflowing joy. So that's a happy time. So 6 comes to real happiness. And this, again, is a development of prose. Prose, you can say, beginning at 5, is very well-developed in phase 6, unimpeded. No impedance. And the bull is happy to rest with the boy. The boy is happy to play music. Becomes creative. Fifth chakra, right? So, playing a tune of peace, overflowing with joy. Playing, peaceful, happy music. And this is a great accomplishment. This is very much like once returner or non-returner. it's at least sotapanna or once returner, the first two stages of awakening from the Pali Canon. But you see there's still a little black at the back and the beast. Maybe it's not even sotapanna. But who can say? Number 7, laissez-faire, which I'd say is wu-wei, no action, or non-interference, non-interruption, as I said about heart chakra. The real nature of love is non-interference, non-interruption. The basis of unconditional accepting as non-controlling is non-interfering and not interrupting. This is a really subtle matter. And so love is about non-interference and non-interruption. Like the law of free will. Law of non-interference, right? So the law of free will is God's love, is the logoic love that all beings are free to make decision and hopefully seek and become one. And that is akin to number 7 here, laissez-faire or wu-wei, which is both are free. And the boy is not a boy anymore, he's a man or becoming a sage. The translation is evening, spring stream, in evening sun, huh? Spring stream in evening sun flows gently by willow-lined bank. In hazy atmosphere, meadow grass grows thick. When hungry, he grazes. When thirsty, he drinks. Time sweetly slides. When I, on the rock dozing for hours, unseeing all around me. And so the bull is so tamed and all white now, and so well. You see, taming the bull is making the mind a happy place. It makes the body enlightened. It taming the mind is enlightening the body. It's training the elementals. It's actually working on the mental elemental. The mental elemental. If you read Alice Bailey Theosophy, you'll see there's the physical, emotional, astral, and mental elementals. These are sort of constituents of the energy bodies that form mind and body. Very metaphysical bases, elemental bases of what comes out as mind and body. They are served. That whole evolution, this is a whole nother behind the curtain. You know, behind the curtain, inside the curtain, above the theater, way, not just behind the curtain, but above the theater, or the beyond the vision of the beyond the visioning of a theater, being seeking and become one, seeking and becoming one, in the octave evolution, soul evolution, is in many ways a training of the elementals, the first density. Spiritualizing a first density life, bringing first density life to second density, training the elementals to coordinate and become mineral, giving the elementals structure and love based light, so that they can move into second density, meaning appear in manifest form as minerals. Ooh, okay. If you know what I mean. Laissez-faire 7. It's beautiful. And so the boy has become a man. The bull is all white. The sun and the distant mountains are visible. It's very happy time. It's like Krishna and the goatherd, the gopis. And he's well, the bull's well. And so that's the point. Why even work on the bull? Why do you even have to go find a bull? Because that's the only way we and the bull can be happy. It's not Buddha nature you're training. Duh, you can't train Buddha nature. It's that which needs training, which begins with what we call the subconscious mind or the lower triad blockages or instinctual tendencies of, you know, upadana skanda and tanha and krillinging and the three unwholesome roots and ashrava and klesha and all that stuff, karmic proliferate, karmic tendencies, karmic binding, karmic self-binding. But metaphysically, this is an awakening of elemental nature, and in a certain sense, it's the only way we can be well. So our own path to freedom demands this kind of service to the instinctual, to enlighten or bring love, light, discipline, and order to the instinctual, the self-instinctual and the universal instinctual, which is elemental. And that's the only way he can become a sage. He can't become a sage without making that relationship to the wild bull in the mountains. But in 7, Wu Wei, everybody's well. Then 8, all forgotten. And here the boy sage becomes something like a Babaji in the heavens, and now they're in the clouds, and now we have the first constellation appearing in figure 8, which is Lyra, which shows you the Taoist root of this. This is a Taoist picture, retranslated multiple times by Chinese Chan and Japanese Zen teachers and students. All forgotten 8. Beast, all white now, surrounded by white clouds, man, the ox herd becomes sage, perfectly at ease, carefree, with companion. White clouds penetrated by moonlight, casting white shadows below. White clouds, a lot of white and bright and light here, you say. White clouds, bright moonlight, each follows its own course. Right? Wu Wei again, but up to heaven. And so there's some sublimation or transubstantiation involved here from 7 to 8. And that's the point, is that the boy on the rock dozing for hours, not noticing, he's forgetting the third density. He's forgetting duality. Forgetting third density and then forgetting duality and then forgetting the lower and only being in the formless, moving out of Kamaloka into Rupaloka, we can say. And the sun is perfectly clear, and the four points of Lyra appear, and they're both in heaven. And so the beast is, there's still a relation, there's still duality here, I guess you can say, between the subject, between a sense of subject and object. Duality is not quite finished yet, but it's about to be. Then, 9, solitary moon. Nowhere is beast. Oxherd is master of his own time. He is a solitary cloud, whitely, wafting lightly, lightly gliding along mountain peaks, clapping hands, I sing joyfully in moonlight, but I know final wall remains, blocking my home, blocking home. I mean, that's that, the Chinese is really that tight, I imagine. Beast gone, I master my time. I alone time master. I, solitary cloud, gliding mountain peaks, clapping hands, I sing joy in moonlight, but no final wall remains blocking home. Final wall before home. And that the home is both vanished, number 10. But they're so the beast vanishes first, then the boy or the figure of a human finally ends. And in higher self, you know, beyond higher self, there's no more human or fivefold basis of selfhood. The seven that's centralized into the five goes back to the one. After, it's really not at higher self level, it's after higher self level. It's only after six density. Hi, guys. It's only after six density that they forget, they drop false identity and memory, of course. But identity is the problem. Without false identity, there's no more limited experience, limitation of the experience of memory, meaning linear perception of temporality or experience or phenomena is finished with the dropping of identity. That's only going from 6 to 7, and that's not yet finished here, you know. So to talk about coming back to the marketplace with bliss bestowing hands and a big belly is really a degradation of the goal. And that's why the Suyun community didn't use that version, I think, because they were taught properly that there's no problem with both vanished. You don't have to return to the marketplace. Everywhere is the marketplace at both vanished. And the path is finished. Rather than the path not finished, return to the marketplace. Actually, the path finished and there's no more marketplace. There's just universal love light streaming forever. So, in 9, solitary moon, I guess it's not the sun, it's the moon there. Very pretty picture. Another constellation, Aquila. And it's actually 7 pointed. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. How about that? So, we go from the four points of Lyra, very much like fourth ray, fourth chakra, to the 7 points or the completed 7 chakra, 7 of Aquila in solitary moon, and then you finish the 7. And then you go beyond astrology or astronomy. Both vanished 10. Both man and bull disappeared, no traces. Bright moonlight empty, shadowless, with all 10,000 things there, here. If anyone asks this meaning, behold lilies of the field and fresh, sweet-smelling pasture. Verdure. So, both man and animal disappeared, no traces remain. Bright moonlight, empty, shadowless, with all 10,000 objects, all 10,000 things. That's a Taoist phrase, you know. If anyone asks meaning, behold lilies of the field and fresh, sweet perfume. Something like that. So, good enough, I think. And you know, there's no more perception of a marketplace distinct from both vanished. In both vanished, there's no more differentiation. And so, of course, there's endless service. So, that's it. And my time is at the end of this hour. So, I recommend also look at the bottom of the notes on YouTube. If you see it, you'll see the links for the podcasts and an archive.org source where you can find this. Again, YouTube is unstable and the world is unstable, and we're moving into a difficult time. So prepare for impact and brace, and get yourselves ready with faith and love and a strong mind and maturity and care to self and all self and others. So I hope this was helpful. Next week we may take a break in our class and have just group talk, so there'll be no posting of a video or of a talk, but the other class will talk. So please take good care of yourselves. Thank you for being here. Take good care and good night.